Do you have the mug? Everybody now. Well, good morning.
Oh, I'm winded.
Man, good morning.
Awesome. I have not been keeping up with my Jane Fonda exercise tapes, and I am winded. That's too much. That's too much aerobicizing for me, guys.
Too much movement in the morning before. Yeah, well, there is coffee, but there needs to be more coffee.
Yeah, and my leg warmers. I'm overheating.
Oh, I see.
So much going on. Hello, gang. How's everybody doing?
Hey, well, you know, we're doing great. It's a beautiful day in Arizona. Looks like everybody's checking in from different parts of the globe. How's it with you guys are?
Oh, yeah. I'm in Toronto and super excited. We're going to have 15 degrees Celsius. I have no idea, Brent, what that is in Fahrenheit, but it's extremely warm for this time of year. So I'm excited.
If my math is right, it's 942 Fahrenheit.
Oh, yeah, especially with your leg warmers. That makes sense.
Yeah, totally. Pardon me while I just peel those off one at a time. Yeah. Here in Eastern Ontario, we're going to hit about 12, I think, which it's got us all goo-goo in the brain because it's just like, oh, my God, spring is here. The snow is going to melt. Yay. And then, of course, being Canadian, we also know that the pessimistic side of us, that it's going to slam us still. Winter will come back and laugh at us. So
exactly. So don't start gardening yet.
Yeah. Yep. Keep the seeds in the house so far.
Indeed. Well, I believe we've skipped our introductions for this morning.
I know. Well, I know that. See, the thing is, Bianca's been with us several times, so it just feels like we're picking up the conversation where we left off the last time, right?
Part of the family, right?
I know. No kidding. Folks, we have Bianca Baumann with us here this morning. Bianca, give us your short introduction to yourself so that maybe there's folks who haven't met you here on Idiotic before.
Absolutely. Well, first off, I'm super excited to be back. It's been a while. Bianca Baumann, I'm Director of Learning Experience Design for GP Strategies. And I've been in the industry for 15 years now, and I love everything that has to do with marketing and learning and development and digital transformations. And super excited to be here with Chris and Brent, and of course everyone on the call today. And we're talking learner personas. One of my favorite topics.
Yes. I was joking with Brent before you joined us in the green room that I felt like I should brought like costumes to change. You know,
well, that would be such a fun idea. We should have thought about that.
And of course, these are the things you think of only right before. If I thought of it yesterday,
right. That would have been fun. Maybe. For sure. Yeah.
No kidding. Oh, Q in the chat's telling us that that we're a permanent dancing gift. Check your Twitter, guys.
He's the master of the gift.
I know. We'll check that out afterwards. But
absolutely,
no kidding. Let's I guess start at the basics with learner personas. I mean, you're pulling the idea of personas over from with a lot of influence, let's say, from the world of marketing. Yeah. So in the world of marketing, what are personas?
So in the world of marketing, they usually look at buyer personas. So they really try to understand the ideal or the typical customer. And then they create these, they make up these personas with really names and pictures and character traits and pain points to really make sure they can deliver the right content at the right time to the right audience. So if you think of the marketing funnel that we all are in and all go through with all kinds of things all the time, it's almost like they know us. They know exactly where we are in this funnel, but they also know who we are as a person because they follow us, of course, online using our digital footprint there. But they really know who we are, and that's why they can serve up the content that is of interest to us, because their end goal is, of course, to make sure we purchase a product or we purchase a service. And that's really where the idea comes from, that buyer persona concept in marketing. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So when we think about that from moving over into our, learning world, is a persona something, different, or is it a variation on the same kind of theme, or how much of a jump is it to take that same kind of idea over?
I don't think it's a big jump at all. The only difference is that, you know, instead of us convincing our learners to purchase something, we want to convince them to be excited about our training and take our training and talk about our training. But our end goal should also still be to engage, right? So marketing engages and or consumers, and we engage our learners. So personas certainly help you do that. And in the L&D world, it's really, it comes from the design thinking aspect as well, right? I mean, that's, I don't want to say a buzzword right now, but I think it is a little bit, like everyone is jumping on the design thinking wagon, but it's that empathy stage, that first stage, that human-centered design. And that's really what it's all about. Instead of thinking about your content first, you want to think about the learner first. Be ruthlessly relevant. What is it that they need in order to be successful? So I don't think it's a big jump. Concept is really, it's really the same.
I like that. Ruthlessly relevant.
Yeah.
Yes. Right? I mean, think about the last meeting you had with your subject matter experts, right? All of this needs to go into the course, right? It's like, well, does it really? What's the nice to have? What's the must have? Let's start there and really, you know, dig down a little deeper. Mm-hmm. And then again, instead of starting from that content perspective, you would actually take the persona and let's just call him Bob, right? It's like, what would Bob think about this, right? Because Bob likes to learn on his own time after hours on his mobile phone, because, you know, in normal times, that's when he's sitting on the train to commute back home. Right. Or it might be Anusha, who actually, you know, likes to listen to podcasts while she's running. So why don't we give her, you know, a podcast that fits into her learner journey and is ruthlessly relevant to her?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It helps us bring in too, not just, I mean, it's easy enough to focus on role, like, you know, Bob is a CSR level 2, you know, and therefore we have other organizational info. But when you describe it that way, you're also adding in context, other contexts beyond simply the job description in that way.
Yeah, and that's such an important point. And I get asked all the time, like, how do you scope learner personas? Where do you start, right? And that is, it is tricky, and there is no easy answer. I'm very sorry. And it takes practice too. It really does. But what I always highly recommend doing is think of your segments first. So those are like the big buckets of character traits, possibly, that someone shares, or it could be geographic regions, it could be business units, operating units. So really, really big, right? It could also be character traits. You've probably seen those personas where it's like, there's the trailblazer and there's the achiever, and right? So kind of bucket them that way, but really start thinking through like the bigger buckets first. And then within each of those buckets, it's almost like a matrix that you could imagine. You would have multiple personas that fit in there. It could be manager, an individual contributor, or it could be the job role, as you were just saying, or it could be, you know, tech savviness or not tech savvy, not being tech savvy. So it takes a little bit of trial and error to start. But I mean, the most important thing is talk to your learners. Never, ever assume, right? Because once you start having these learner interviews, you'll actually be able to, you know, put them into the buckets, into your assumed buckets, let's just put it that way. And then you might have to change the buckets down the road.
Mm-hmm. Are there any common buckets we can reach into, like that have already existed? Like you were saying, like there's the achiever, there's the adventurer, whatever. I mean, personality traits, I guess, play into a lot of this, and certain personalities do have a tendency to gravitate into particular jobs.
Yes.
And those types of things. So is there a way we can like leapfrog a lot of this and start with somebody else's work that's already been done?
You know what? Absolutely. And, you know, I almost have the same starting point all the time. It's, for me, the segments are usually business units. They are these character traits, like, you know, just achiever, the trailblazer, the, you know, the cuddler, whatever you want to call it, right? Like the people that are much more emotional, the collaborator, whatever they're called. And often that works. But then sometimes, you know, you go into conversations with the key stakeholders, leadership, whoever needs to be at the table, and you realize, oh, that doesn't work, because because, you know, of the political environment. We can't go into business units, for example, right? Or it would be too granular. But yeah, I usually always start business units or geographic regions, those character traits. Those are some three good starting points, because you got to start somewhere. And then, you know, you start making your assumptions and then you either prove them right or wrong and you go from there and make the changes. But yeah, absolutely. Little cheat sheet, so to say.
Brent, I don't know if you saw, James has got a note in there about your MIC level. I don't know if you saw that or not, but
I did see that, but it looks like it's pumping. It's
alrighty.
It is clipping on my side. So
alrighty. Well, we'll keep rolling, but we definitely, we welcome the feedback because in this day and age, gosh,
that, James,
so many things can alter even in the midst of a session from one to the next. Yeah. If there can be a goofy moment, we've had most of them. That's for sure.
I'm sure you can write a book about it.
Yeah. We mostly just try to forget them.
That's an option too.
So like if you're mapping out learner personas, how many? Like how many personas do you need?
Yeah. So my rule of thumb, roughly 3 to 5, but so let me answer this a little bit more. So first of all, what I want to say as well is like, you don't create learner personas for one training initiative or one training program. You create them for your organization. So I think that's the first thing you really want to remember, because it does somehow influence how many you want to create. It doesn't mean that once you create them, you forget about them. No. You have to revisit and adjust for each initiative, right? But yeah, you kind of set them in, you know, when you have a good big old program, like a, you know, compliance training or onboarding, those are great starting points to get into the learner personas because it's something that touches the entire organization, right? And then you can really go into the nitty-gritty. So I like 3 to 5 because that gives me a workable amount of different options, because the end goal of using personas is that we're trying to personalize the training as much as possible, which, you know, and I have these conversations all the time, you can't get them all. I hate to tell you this, learner personas are not the solution for everything that's wrong in learning and development. I wish it was, but it's not. So what I'm trying to say is it is still better than your typical or traditional learner analysis. That's usually somewhat, you know, some demographic information, because you go much deeper. You go into the emotional level. You really think about what do they think and feel, right? And so if you have 3 to 5, it really allows you to think through these bigger programs and say, okay, I can have variation of my core program for 3 to 5 different personas. If I had 20, well, we don't have enough time and money and budget to, you know, do what we're doing. So now you're asking me to create 20 different programs. It's just not realistic, right? Mm-hmm. And you would just get lost in the weeds. So yeah, I usually say start with 3 to 5, and then you can always build from there as well. But what you will also find is, you know, the more you have, the more they will have in common again. And you're like, you know, actually I can kind of combine these two, right?
So. Sure. Yeah, and that's partly what I was thinking was like, I mean, you could end up potentially in learner persona paralysis, you know, it's theoretically depending on. When you're thinking about a more global kind of audience, you know, across multiple geographies, I'm presuming that also means more personas, though, that would be probably needed.
Absolutely. And that's where the segments come in again, right? So you might end up having 3 to 5 personas in one segment, right? And then, yeah, you have multiple because, yeah, there is cultural differences for sure, right? So the bigger the organization, the bigger the number of personas most likely. But again, keep it somewhat, you know, actionable for yourself, because otherwise you're just, you're not helping yourself. You're not helping the learner, right?
Like, it's interesting not to use them as... your comment about not for the individual courses, because I think some instructional designers get stuck in that analysis a little bit when they're just being asked to create one course, right? Oh, sorry. I'm trying to keep my volume spiked up there for you, but I think Crowdcast is muffling me. I think that they... like it's a strategic thing, right? And you want to, once you've got that whole organization, if you are a contractor, do you spend a lot of time, or should you spend a lot of time thinking about that persona side of it? Or is that something that's an added thing? Because I could see you, I could see a contractor that's been told, hey, we need a course mm-hmm. created. And if you mm-hmm. say, well, I need to know who your audience is and I'm going to create some personas for you, that's going to take a lot of extra time mm-hmm. and they may not really need it, right?
I couldn't agree more. So there's a time and a place for this. Mm-hmm. I mean, ideally, as you come in as a contractor, I think that's a perfect example, because I know we have a lot of those on your call, right? I think I would always ask the question, do you have learner personas? And just kind of gently nudge the organization to maybe do that on the strategic level, because it will help the organization overall. But yeah, if you come in and create a 30-minute e-learning course on something, right, it's not worth going into creating them. I mean, you know, by the time you interview people, I usually like to interview around 20 to 30 learners if I can, right? As you get above 30, I feel it's very repetitive, which is a good thing, right? Because it really just tells you, like, yep, this is exactly where I need to go. And I also like to have collaborative workshops with managers and key stakeholders where we actually brainstorm. So it's more like, what do you think your learners see every day? What do you think they hear? What do you think they think? What do you think their pain points are, right? And so you brainstorm this typical learner and you come up with like their names and their interests and, you know, whatever it might be. And then you have these learner persona interview or the learner interviews, and then you kind of combine the two. So to your point, Brent, if I have to create a 30-minute e-learning module, it definitely makes no sense to spend about, you know, a month worth of work in order to just find out who the learners are. So yeah, couldn't mm-hmm. agree more.
And the fact of the matter is, if you're an outside contractor, well, first of all, it's a deliverable on its own, isn't it? Like the massive amount of Absolutely. Potentially work. Yeah. So if it's not in the contract, right? But, mm-hmm. you know, secondly, even if you had all of that work that you did put in coming from the outside, can the organization even make use of it? Is the organization even going to make use of it?
You know, that's the other thing. Yeah. I mean, for a 30-minute module, what I could imagine is that, you know, maybe the intro is different for each persona, right? But then again, how do you actually manage that on your LMS system to make mm-hmm. sure, you know, people get the right course, and you, like, now you're getting into, you know, really, really hot water there. Yeah. Whereas for me, learner personas are connected to learner journey. Right, where you really envision an experience over multiple weeks or month, even with multiple touch points. And then to come back to the concept of ruthlessly relevant, you know, let's just say there's 20 touch points, but, you know, our Bob persona only needs 10 of those touch points because he already has all the other stuff in his back pocket, right? And Anusha actually needs all 20. But then even within those touch points, there's different options on how to access the content. It's still the same content, but one might be, you know, in an e-learning module, one might be in a podcast, one might be, you know, just read a PDF, whatever it is. But this is really, for me, I combine learner personas in my head with learner journeys, really.
Yeah, it's interesting the different types of inputs that we could possibly mm-hmm. need. Got a question in the chat, and it's funny, I was thinking the exact same thing. So it's like, maybe let's get a little tactical here. Like, what are those things? And is there potentially like a list of questions that you typically ask when you're going through those interviews, or mm-hmm. are there other inputs that allow us to help create these personas?
Absolutely. So I usually break them up into four buckets of see, hear, do, think, and feel. And then in each of those buckets, I have very plain questions. What do they see? What do they hear? Right. So it's very, very plain. But you would be surprised what you actually get out of, you know, those collaborative workshops when you talk to the managers and the key stakeholders. I also have questions such as, what do you think they hear from other people? And I like to keep the questions basic and generic and not focused on learning, because if I say, what do they hear about learning, then they answer the question about learning. But here's the mm-hmm. problem with that question. First off, I'm leading them towards just thinking about learning, but also, what does learning mean to you? It might be different to what learning means to me. So I just had that experience where I was actually consulting an organization on or helping them, you know, just sitting in their interviews, and they had a ton of leading questions. And then sure enough, the person, the learner was saying, when she heard learning, she only thought of, oh, that's when I go to the LMS. But as we all know, learning is coaching and mentoring. And, you know, I go and Google something, whatever it might be. She didn't even think about that. So that's why I like to keep the question somewhat open, right? But I do ask, like, you know, what do they hear from other people? What do they see when they're at work, right? The toughest question is usually, like, what do they hear? It's like, what do you mean? Do they listen to music? I'm like, sure, that could be it, because it influences who they are and what they do. I also ask questions around what do they do outside of work? Because whatever they're interested in outside of work, they bring that to work. It's still the same person, right? They still have those same interests. So can I leverage that somehow? So that's definitely important. So I have some of those questions. Sometimes when I just have interviews with key stakeholders, I have the, you know, standard almost needs analysis questions in terms of what are some of the pain points you see? What are some of the challenges, right? Like rather broad as well. Yeah. You can have additional data sources, just like HR data, right? Observational data, things like that, that you could combine. But those are like the three data sources, I'd say.
Have you seen any of it change over the last year or so, right? Like we were talking in the green room ahead of time, and I got to thinking, oh yeah, I guess I think the personas might shift up a little bit with people working from home now instead of going into the office, because people bring a different self into the office than they have when they're working from home.
Yes, absolutely. We've certainly seen a shift. We've worked with organizations that kind of revisited their learner personas because of that, right? For newly created personas, you certainly see the shift more towards what's actually happening while they're sitting in their office, which we all know the office might be the kitchen table, and there's like two other people sitting at that table, and everyone is talking to someone else, right? So, but that environment is extremely important. And again, it's not just a learning environment, but it is the work environment itself, because in the end, we're in the business of performance, right? And not just learning and training. And there's so much more that goes into this. And sometimes we identify a pain point where it's like, oh, no one uses the copier. I don't know, it's always my go-to example, but it's like, well, no one uses the copier because it's like five flights of stairs up and no one wants to go there, right? But it's not that people don't know how to use the copier. So just move the copier, right? and if you ask learning specific questions, you would never even get there. So, you know, keep them open. That's my message here.
Yeah, it always comes back to what's the problem that needs to be solved, as opposed to the. So let's shift. Let's say we've got our learner personas. We've got that all set up, and we've done the things that we need to do for that. What do we do with them?
Now what? You know what happens a lot of time, and it's really sad. Nothing happens, because it's a checkbox exercise. It becomes this buzzword of like, hey, we created learner personas. We're awesome. We're now doing modern learning. Well, yeah, but you have to do something with these personas. So, and I'm laughing about this, but it's actually really sad. and I've seen it multiple times that, you know, they're not going to be brought back in. So really, really important, once the personas are created, often instructional designers don't know that this happened in the first place, because it happens at a strategic level. So first off, internally, educate your staff on, hey, we have these learner personas now, right? So that might be instructional designers, it might be your performance consultant, it might be anyone who, you know, touches anything related to training and development in the organization. And it doesn't hurt to also talk to, you know, different business units and leaders there to just say, hey, this is a new approach we're using, you know, just FYI kind of thing. But then, you know, designers really need to start implementing them. So as they start working through new training initiatives, as I said before, instead of thinking content first, they think person first. So how would Anusha actually, you know, take this compliance training? What are some of the things that would work for her? Start using those names. It might sound really silly, but it actually does work. But on that note, make sure what you call them, because it's going to stick. And so, yeah, use them. And then, you know, as you create your different iterations, if you work agile or if you still work waterfalls, you have like, you know, your very traditional design document, storyboard, whatever it might be, alpha, beta, you know, at every checkpoint, go back to your persona and say, hey, did I actually hit all these, you know, pain points that I know, all the needs that I know this person has? So, yeah, they constantly have to be brought up at every milestone, no matter if it's agile. A waterfall. And then also, once you roll out that program, double check again on the learner personas, like, hey, did we get this right? And getting learners' input here is extremely important as well. So as you create those learner personas, before you start using them, have learners look at them, say, hey, do you see yourself in this? Because what often happens is that we put biases into creating personas. We are either way too negative or way too positive. And I find myself doing the same thing. It's just, I think, human. I don't know, right? So I always have to I have to check myself during these sessions and the creation of the personas. I'm like, oh, am I biased here? Do I have a stereotype in here, right? And when you then start designing and developing, it's a great way to double check those biases to make sure they're not in there.
Mm-hmm. And I know as we got started in this, and you were describing, you know, some of the kind of some example personas, and we mentioned, you know, podcast or etc. So there's a great question from Jill in the question panel. Do you apply personas in material development in other ways other than choices of delivery options? I mean, so are we strictly, you know, using these personas to figure out how the content type is for these different folks, or what else do we do with them?
Yeah, great question. Tone of voice as well. How do these people like to be talked to? And that then also ties into your adoption and promotion of the content, right? As you write emails to promote the content, as you have your maintenance after, right? Like, what does that look like? That whole engagement and adoption piece around what we're doing. So it helps. Draft those communications as well. And delivery channel, content itself, the tone of voice. I think those are the three biggest areas to use them. Great question. Mm-hmm.
And I would think too, it also plays into some of the contextual aspects of the content itself, types of examples, making sure that they're related to the real world of the, you know, the different, you know, personas, because this does tie into roles too, obviously, too.
So. Absolutely. Yeah. 100%. Yeah. Right. There might be different examples. Yeah.
Oh. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So if we're doing different content deliveries, I mean, you even mentioned a few minutes ago, Bob needs 10 of these things. Anusha needs all 20. Mm. I'm trying to figure out what my question really is. How do we make sure that the organization itself is comfortable with this notion that maybe not everybody needs everything?
How much time do you have?
I know. Can of worms.
Right. Absolutely. Right. It's a very loaded question. And I think it's education. It's really education. Yeah. It's being patient. It's, you know, setting expectations from the get-go. So as you go off and start creating those learner personas, get buy-in from, you know, the people that need to give you the buy-in, so you can use it moving, can use them moving forward, because it is that notion of, what do you mean they have to look at everything, right? I think I'm hoping we're seeing a bit of a shift really towards that, partially through the pandemic as well, but just in general, even before COVID hit, I saw that organizations are becoming a little bit more comfortable. But in the end, it really comes back to managing expectations, educating your stakeholders on modern learning principles, right? Mm-hmm. So I know it's a very kind of like fluffy answer, but that's really,
yeah, but it's something that we all, that everybody who tries to move in this newer direction has to sort of wrestle with and even if your own learning team is all on board, somebody's got a boss above them somewhere who goes, yes, but what about that one little thing? And I guess there's also in some of these things legal ramifications, right? If you can't demonstrate that everybody has been presented with all of the checks in the boxes, then the organization may be at risk as well. So,
Absolutely. I mean, from a compliance perspective, we've all been there, right? We have to check certain boxes. But then again, you know, instead of having a learner go through 3 hours of compliance training, can we spread it out over the next 4 months and they take 10 minutes every day, right? Yeah. Yes, they would have to take all the 10 minutes, but, you know, now you can take something that was a course and make it actually into an experience with the help of learner personas to say, hey, let's make compliance training fun.
This is absolutely fabulous. Kim's sharing in the chat an aha moment. With cognitive load, I can use learning learner personas when creating the connection to prior knowledge. That's very cool. Totally.
I love that. Great comment.
Sure. And Mitch has shared an example of quote, and he's putting these quotes in, how they feel impacting content. I designed the sexual harassment piece targeting people who had been charged with it as part of remediation. And I took an approach that was different from what I would use for an orientation because of the complex feelings, guilt, resistance, bias, that might need to be addressed. Yeah, I mean, there's a whole different context involved in, you know, you're part of a legal proceeding versus the thou shalt not aspect of a lot of compliance, for sure.
I love switching that, for sure. But yeah, it's that feeling aspect here. And for some reason, I don't know why it is, it's almost like, you're an instructional designer, you can't talk about feelings. Don't go there. It's like, I know, that is what motivates us and what drives us.
I know. So and then the legal team has to get involved and they erase all of that and want to put the compliant related you know, language back into everything as well.
How do you switch like between the different elements of e-learning and training and stuff that we do, from the soft skills to the hard skills? How do the personas apply uniquely to one or the other, if at all?
I think they apply just equally to both, right? So I wouldn't actually, you know, it's interesting, no one ever asked me that question, Brent, but I would just use them the exact same way. I don't think there's a difference in, you know, because in the end, it's all a learner experience. Yeah. It doesn't matter, you know, what you're actually teaching there. So yeah, I would certainly use them. I would use them.
So I think a lot of what we do is, the only reason why I think about it is a lot of what we do is pretty tactical, right? Sometimes it's just, hey, somebody needs to learn a process. And it's like, so how, why do I need to know how they feel and how they do all these things if I just need to train a process, right?
And then absolutely. And I think that goes back to your earlier question. If it's just a course, you know, probably don't even worry about the learner persona so much, right? So absolutely. There's, I mean, we could have very strong feelings about a specific process, but I don't think those feelings are that relevant in this scenario.
Yeah, as opposed to like doing leadership training, for example, right? Yes. Getting to know how people think, how they feel, how they engage with other people, all that kind of stuff. Then it becomes, I think, really, really important to know a lot of this, to have an understanding of a basic persona.
Yeah, I agree. I think where the feelings might come in a little bit more for those process, you know, modules is really like their feelings towards learning in general. So then it would help me more with the communication aspect about how can I get them possibly excited, even if I know they hate the process. So, you know, it's probably more on the communication side than the actual learning experience, which if you really argue it, you know, for me, the communication piece is part of the learning experience. But that's a topic for a different session.
and you mentioned it before, like, you know, one persona might enjoy listening to podcasts, and I almost didn't say that because I didn't want people to start thinking I was talking about learning styles, and I'm not.
No, exactly. Different
media consumption, right? So like somebody might do that, and I've known a ton of people who are like, I don't understand how you can listen to podcasts. I just can't stand listening to people talk, and like, they just like when they're listening to something, it just has to be music, and you know, and they just are set in their ways and that's it. So I started thinking about using learning personas when we're thinking about creating multiple solutions, right, for a particular thing. So maybe part of your training is it's all the same training, but it's delivered in different mediums, right?
Yes.
And some people might think that that is like, oh, it's pretty redundant, right? And it's like, no, not really, because each medium is there to support a different persona, right?
Yes, absolutely. And you hit the nail on the head there. Again, going back to my comment around often we're a one-woman man show. There's no time and budget. So what Bianca, now you asked me to create 20 programs. No, the core program stays the same, but there's variations to it, right? And the content delivery mechanism changes, or the examples changes, as Chris was saying earlier, right? So you're really trying to still, you know, stay to the core as much as possible, but you have like, you know, little pieces that you're changing. And that's why for me, learner personas go well with learner journeys, because learner journeys are small, bite-sized Lego building blocks. And then I decide for each persona how I want to put those building blocks together, you know, to create that experience for them that works for them. So, you know, it might end up one person has a skyscraper, whereas another person has, you know, a little cottage at the lake, and, you know, just still the same building blocks, but it's very different shape overall, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. James has got a question in the question panel that I think connects to this idea. Based on the work effort required to determine personas and modify courses or content to suit them, is there a time or place for instead focusing on very clear naming conventions and descriptions for resources that allow the user to find the solution they need based on their innate knowledge of their own persona, pull versus push? In other words, how does this play? Or in other words, my interpretation then is this. I mean, we've been talking about thou shalt take this, and we're going to use the personas for making that a better experience. But the, you know, how does this tie into helping learners find the things on their own that they need?
Absolutely. Again, I'm going back to my learner journey experience example. I always built in push and pull. And depending on the learner persona, they're not the pulling kind of guy. So you don't even want to go there, because we're expecting them to pull something because, hey, that's what we do now. But not everyone wants that.
Right.
Excuse me. So you have to keep that in mind. So one learner persona might really be like, you know what? I need to be spoon fed. You know, give it to me all, you know, I don't want to go somewhere and find things. However, you know, I still think it's really important to have certain, you know, naming conventions or resources to make sure people are able to find what they need, which goes back to the ruthlessly relevant. And I would argue, as you build your learner personas and then the content around those personas, automatically you will be able to have the right language so they find what they're looking for, right? Mm-hmm. But yeah, push and pull equally important, but might not be important equally to each of the personas. So that's why we're building them, to find out, right?
Yeah, and it ties in, I think, pretty nicely into some of our previous conversations about how we connect with marketing and what marketing does, right? And so, so being able to be clear, being able to write headlines, for example, right?
Yes.
You know, and or just to, you know, to be able to write things that are easily understandable and things like that, and just being able to hit those personas and to know, you know, what's going to hit that different market in different ways is part of this, right? It's part of putting those pieces together. As we start to get close to our time here, I do have one kind of wrap-up question in my mind that just hit me was, is there a way to tie back successes with our training, right? Everybody loves to talk about data and analytics and everything. Mm-hmm. Is there a way to tie back the success or the improvement to an existing course to the fact that we did personas, so people can start to look at proving that it's worth the time and worth the cost to go through this process?
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. I mean, it is time intensive to do that, but ideally you would have the before and the after data, right? So let's go back to our onboarding example. You had your onboarding program before. Hopefully you already captured some data around that, and not just bumps in seats, but, you know, you're really also looking at some of the qualitative data, some sentiment analysis, engagement information, which can come from a platform, but it can also come from, you know, observation, surveys, whatever it might be. And then after, I would simply look at the same data points and say, hey, you know, now based on, you know, we personalized the onboarding program more. So now, you know, we have seen an increase in, yes, you know, people accessing just accessing content, but also from a sentiment perspective. Like, you know, we look at the qualitative data and we see much improved positive feedback around the different experiences, and ideally you would see that across the board. So yeah, absolutely, it is time intensive to do it, but the before and after should certainly help you do that. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And then that helps you convince the naysayers or the fearful folks that the whole thing actually does play out and
absolutely and I think that's a really good comment there, right? Instead of going out and you know, spending 3-4 months on creating learner personas, which you could easily do, you know, start small, you know, do something real quick and dirty. Like, you know, I run sessions at conferences where we actually create a learner persona in 45 minutes. Don't overthink it, right? Have a starting point at least and get people to, you know, think about the concept itself. Don't over engineer it. You can always make changes later, right? Just one piece of advice I would share before we close out. I had one experience where we actually created a learner persona based on someone in the room. And I didn't know it. I could only tell that all of a sudden something shifted. And it was an accounting firm, and there were like 3 partners in the room and one person, well, 2 partners and 1 possible partner. And that possible partner was like, well, you know, I want to be partner. And one existing partner was supportive of this and the other one wasn't. And they played it out on the back of creating this learner persona. Most awkward situation ever, because I'm like, okay, what is going on? The learning person in the room didn't know what was going on, and eventually, like, we actually had to stop the workshop. Like, it went like crazy. So anyway, don't build a persona based on someone in the room. It's not a good idea.
Yes. Awkward.
Just a little.
Yikes. Yeah. That is an interesting way to end. Now my mind is spinning, and I hope you scare people away from personas.
I hope not. I hope not.
Hey, you know what? It's been a pleasure having you as always. Why don't you drop in some links into the chat? Let people know how they can reach you.
Sure, absolutely. I'm certainly on Twitter, and I am on LinkedIn too. So let me just quickly grab that link. I should have known. I should have had them ready. You always ask, and
And we were so casual in the green room and prep that I actually forgot to nudge you on that too.
Right? So
I'll take the blame for that one. The problem was we had already developed the Bianca persona, having been here before. We forgot to revise it or to update it or to make sure that it was still current. Bianca, thanks so much for joining us. This has been absolutely fabulous. Thanks to our folks in the chat and the questions, always bringing great forward stuff to us here, and so glad to have everybody here. And you know, fingers crossed for those of us in the snowy world that the warmth that we're seeing this week continues on and becomes something real for us. So
absolutely, thanks, Brent. Thanks, Chris, for having me. I had a great time. Talk to you soon.
Thanks, everybody. Bye.